Hello, hello, and welcome everybody to the Evangelist Nick Garrett channel. It's been a little over a week since we last spoke. This is the Truth First Christianity in a Post-Christian World podcast. I am your host, Evangelist Nick Garrett. This is episode 6. Want to start by telling you about the week I had, because it had so many lessons for growing Christians in it. Let's face reality. In the social media world, the stuff we put out there about our families shows how perfect they all are. We're like Martha Stewart and our mom makes cookies and we play with our kids enough and everybody's beautiful and everything's great. But we know the reality of human life is sometimes harder. It's harder when you have a relative in the hospital. You get, you know, all sorts of things going through your head, especially as your parents get older and you're constantly weighing that line between living your own life, setting firm boundaries, taking good care of your own children, and honoring your mother and father. Their needs change as they get older. So anyway, we had a scare. My mom ended up in the hospital. I ended up having to cancel the invocation that I give before the local government, the county commissioners, which is something I love to do. But obviously under this circumstances, I needed to be with my mom and, you know, God, for the first time in our life, my brother and I actually worked together like responsible adults. It was quite remarkable, but my mom's on the mend. I would ask for your continued prayers, and we were able to help her over the weekend, get her house squared away and get her healthy and on track. And we came up with a new plan for kind of going to check on her and stuff like that. Oh, what else? Oh my gosh, let's talk about Game of Thrones for a minute. And I want to tell you why, because there's a Christian parallel now. This week, I cannot tell you how many articles I saw that talked about, should Christians be watching Game of Thrones? Like, what? We were told to live in the world, not of it. Where would the Lord Jesus teach us to hide from a television show? Now, there's two sides to it, even with me. Brand new Christian, period of milk, maybe not. Keep your nose in the word. Learn what it means to develop that relationship with the Lord in prayer. But those in the period of meat, should we not be reviewing the cultural realities of our time and this continued de-evolution to nihilism and just all these crazy secular ideas that we have. Now, that's only part of the reason. I mean, the other reason is it's an enjoyable show. It's entertaining. But why, as Christians, would we be bothered by it? Well, it's evident. We have lust of the flesh, softcore porn, people having sex outside of marriage, violence, just wanton violence, greed, every defect of character on open display. But I learned a while back that there is something to watching Game of Thrones that gives you insight into the human condition and has some biblical parallels to it. And I found a biblical parallel in this most recent episode. There's one more left before the last episode, and this one was called The Bells. And let me set just a very basic background. Every week between shows, social media blows up, and it's people talking about and debating who's going to sit on the Iron Throne and why, and they predict the political scheming and the Machiavellian, referring to his book The Prince, and about how power worked during the Renaissance era, you know, and who's going to be the king and why, and there's all these theories, and that's about the extent that we all get to. So, the Queen of Dragons, who has a literal dragon in this fantasy, 6 volumes written by George R.R. Martin, she is going to go to the town of King's Landing and she's going to overthrow the Lannister Baratheon line. These are the names of great houses who happen to be king. Robert Baratheon overthrew the Targaryens and now the Targaryens are back with their dragons to reclaim what is rightfully theirs. But the caveat is that the Targaryens are potentially mad. Sir Barristan Selmy of the Kingsguard says, when the gods saw a Targaryen brought into the world, they flip a coin as to whether or not they'll be mad. Insane. So Daenerys Targaryen has her army. She storms King's Landing. She essentially wins this battle in a 10-minute period. Everybody else throws down their arms. The king, King's Landing, the town, they ring the bell, signaling, we surrender, we surrender. But then they zoom in on Daenerys Targaryen, and there's the, you know, ominous music, like the, you know, the low strings on F sharp. And she goes crazy. And she snaps, and she flies with her dragon, and for a second you think she's flying toward the Red Keep. Maybe I'm gonna go claim mine. Maybe I'm gonna go take down the Queen Cersei Lannister. But no. She starts to destroy King's Landing that has over 1 million residents in it. She kills everyone, destroys every building, kills her own people, goes completely insane. And right away I thought to myself, wow. Even in this secular TV show, the end point, the end game, we can't predict what's going to happen. God is in control. None of us saw this coming. God is in control, and humanity is morally depraved. Doctrine of man's total depravity. We see these things on open display right there. And this whole series was good for making us question the gray areas of morality. For example, a subtlety was that every character in the show who demonstrated great honor couldn't survive in politics and ended up getting killed. Anyway, so it's a fascinating show in that regard. Can it be watched responsibly? Are you somebody who is easily susceptible to repeating the things you hear on TV, repeating bad language that you hear on TV? Pray to God to help you to stay away from those things. But if you're somebody whose defects and flaws are different and you have prayed to God and you have the ability to keep something that is entertainment in the realm that it belongs, you can watch it. But everything for the glory of God. I'm frequently watching things to try to learn about the culture of the world we live in for the greater purpose of evangelizing in a way that works for me. I often get heat on my channel because you don't hear the regular nomenclature from me. Brother, did you know you're a sinner? Did you know there's another way in Jesus Christ our Lord? I don't speak that way. I believe that the nomenclature of the past 60 to 100 years is why people aren't coming to Christ. They've heard it so many times on TV from crooked evangelists that it just doesn't register anymore. So I purposely try to make videos that use entirely new language, entirely new perspective, based on truth first Christianity. At that core, the truth of Jesus Christ, and we build out from there. So anyway, let's take a look now at some important news going on around the world, around the Christian world specifically, relative to the material we cover. First up, something we touched on in podcast 5, we talked a lot about this idea of global versus national, and I want to give a shout out to a channel, I'll give the name at the end, that I enjoyed watching to stay up with current events. Now, as you know, we have mixed feelings about Catholicism, but I have taught and echoed over and over again, and I have quoted Dinesh D'Souza, you cannot properly understand Christianity and evaluate it as a whole without all the sum of its parts. And that means we have to keep up with the news coming out of Rome too. And for once, there's some good news coming out of Rome. Let me tell you about it. I get this news often from the channel of a man named Dr. Taylor Marshall. He's the best-selling author of The Crucified Rabbi, The Eternal City, and Sword and Serpent. He produces weekly videos ranging in content from current events, news, history, and follows the battle between globalism and nationalism more than any, perhaps. He's often joined by the teacher and theologian Timothy Gordon. And this week he had an analysis of Pope Francis, who at this point is universally agreed upon as a heretic. He's changed the rules and definitions of canon law about abuse in the church. This is actually a good thing, though. But he also covers globalist, supranationalist bodies. I'm going to get more into that in a second. On May 10th, 2019, the Pope issued a new motu proprio. Remember that word? We've used the word dubia also. There's a lot of Latin nomenclature in the church that mean different things. He issued a new motu proprio regarding abuse. It includes redefining what a minor is, and it added that child pornography is a direct violation of the sixth commandment. Well, thank you for saying something, Christian. Wonderful. Until this relevant change to canon law, you got to go back to like 1917, 1983, which I believe was Pope John Paul II on the family. Something on the family was his change to canon law then. The drawback, though, is that Pope Francis continues to be the most vocal world leader for globalism and now seems to be supporting the idea of supranational entities as well. It is no secret that the UN and the Vatican are in lockstep on some of the most influential social worldwide organizations, and that they're being used to drum up support for the idea that nationalism is evil. In fact, in his remarks, the Pope flat out said that. He used the word patriotism to mislead people into a false sense of protecting one's national identity, but by giving it up to the utopian worldwide collective. Does that sound familiar? The Pope seems to be encouraging the formation of stronger international legislative bodies with the power to inflict their will on sovereign nations. That in itself is quite alarming. In their report, Timothy Gordon created a distinction, though, that is helpful. He created a distinction between globalism as a cultural philosophy, the diversity is our strength idea, and equity of outcome, and support for global government. Globalism, support for global government, which the Pope is advocating now. A global government with power to step in over the constitutions of national governments to inflict their will. The reason that the carbon tax, for example, from alleged global warming became such a hot button issue is that it would have represented the first time in world history that an international tax would be levied on nations and by default the people that live in those nations. The Pope's positions are not unique or of his own creation. One could argue that the UN's Agenda 2030 is driving many of the talking points he's bringing up in the public square. On the surface, Agenda 2030 sounds noble and good, just like Agenda 21 did. Agenda 21, what is it, you ask? Well, in the years leading up to it, if you remember, that was one of those conspiracy tinfoil hat things. Agenda 21, what are you talking about? Agenda 21's a great program. It buys up private land and keeps it in preservation. And it's smart growth that controls the way we develop things. And we have smart meters that we can put in your house to regulate your temperature so we don't waste energy. All these things are noble until you trace it to the top and realize that essentially governments are giving power to a small group of people to decide what the rest of us can and can't do. Not all world governments are the same. Some are communists, some are socialists, some are nationalists, some are republics. How would something like that work? So anyway, to adopt it, a nation would give some of its authority and power to the international body, far removed from its people, their laws, and the authority they give the government to tax them of their own resources. So why would the Pope support these positions? It's simple. Name one other worldwide Christian organization or religious organization large enough to compete with the Catholic Church down the road. One of the drawbacks of the Protestant Reformation, everything got splintered. Everything became subjective. Jim and Bob on the board of deacons disagree about a point of theology and they split up and make their own church. You don't see that kind of stuff happen in the Catholic Church. So they're big and they're rich and they're worldwide. And they are uniquely suited to usher in one world government when the time comes. So in order to see his desires come to fruition, his support of enhanced strength for any potential global legislative body of the three, judicial, executive, legislative, only one makes binding laws, legislative. It's just another controversy in the line of Amoris Laetitia, where the Pope is issuing counter-Christian edicts that have lower-level clergy and bishops reeling and curious about what it is they're supposed to do. Raymond Arroyo, on the May 2nd, 2019 episode of The World Over, reported an open letter. He reported an open letter submitted to Pope Francis from at least 51 theologians, academics, and clergy, calling on bishops to admonish and possibly charge Pope Francis with the canonical delict of heresy. This is the second time since 2016 that a group of prominent Catholics have done this. In 2016, three such inquiries, dubia, or outright accusations, were sent to Rome, one by cardinals themselves. There are key accusations, and they are as follows. The accusations of heresy against Pope Francis are as follows. A Christian believer can have full knowledge of a divine law and voluntarily choose to break it in a serious manner, but not be in a state of mortal sin as a result of his action. Number two, conscience can truly and rightly judge the sexual acts between persons who have contracted a civil marriage with each other, although one or more of them is sacramentally married to another person, can sometimes be morally right or requested or even commanded by God. Number three, it is false that the only sexual acts that are good of their kind and morally licit are acts between a husband and a wife. These are the words of the Pope. Number four, God not only permits but positively wills the pluralism and diversity of religions, both Christian and non-Christian. Wow. Number five, they expressed concerns that the Pope had appointed heretics and alleged sexual criminals to high offices. So by comparing the words of the Pope to his actions, they've determined that the Pope is in fact in a state of heresy. For any Catholics who believe themselves to be born again, converted Christians, there's a definite conflict between the political maneuvering and rhetoric of the papacy and the values of Christianity that can't be reconciled biblically. Anyway, so next up, my friends, I want to take a few moments to go over the books that I've written, give you a chance to take a quick look at them. You can order them all on Amazon, but I figured I've never taken the time to actually show them to you, so I want to. The first book I wrote was called Just Tell Me the Truth About Christianity. It was over 1,000 pages, had thousands of footnotes. It was too big and gangling, so I thought, you know what? Let's break it down. Let's make the Just Tell Me the Truth About Christianity series. So that's what I did. This book here, it's about 200 pages, and it's got roughly the same number of footnotes. Just Tell Me the Truth About the Holy Land Crusades. Now, there were crusades in the Baltic, there were crusades in Eastern Europe, and there were crusades elsewhere. I focused on the 9 crusades to the Holy Land that in some way involved, edicts by church or ongoing hostilities. The book starts naturally with a chapter on the rise of Islam. You can't tell this story without telling the story of the rise of Islam. After that, I have a chapter about Islamic encroachment and the permanent East-West schism in the church, because both play into this. It's important to know that within 100 years of Islam forming, they had taken North Africa, the Levant, They were on the doorstep of Eastern Europe. They had taken Spain, and they were on the doorstep of France. It was Charles Martel at the Battle of Tours that halted him. And for hundreds of years, the dynamic was back and forth until the 1090s when Pope Urban II came onto the scene. And not only did he establish the idea of crusading, but he did something unique around it, this idea of a holy war, of fighting for God. Now, the early crusades were unquestionably about clearing Arabs and Saracens out of the Holy Land that had historically belonged to Christians or Jews. As my book reveals, because I used Jewish, Muslim, and Christian sources, the later ones were not. I do not hide from Christian atrocity, but the idea that we should apologize is heinous. It's wrong. The First Crusade kicks off when the emperor of the East Christian Church, Alexios Komnenos, sends some men over to Pope Urban II and says, hey, we need your help. They are literally right across the Bosporus and coming. That's the catalyst for it. The net result of the First Crusade is that the Crusaders take back Jerusalem for Christendom. The Crusades happen over several hundred years. The Second Crusade happens when one of the first cities taken during the First Crusade fall and the first generation of Crusaders died. The city of Edessa fell, and the Christian Crusaders ended up back in the Middle East. This did not go well for them. With no way of taking Jerusalem, they decided to attack towns in Syria, and it did not work well for them. So between the Second and Third Crusade, you have the rise and power of Saladin, who was an amazingly loved leader. In the 1180s, you have the Battle of Hattin. Soon after, I think it's 1187, he takes Jerusalem back from the Christians, and he holds it. Richard III, the Lionhearted, another popular name we know, did give Saladin a run for his money, and it was a quite amazing war. And it continues in that vein. We get pictures of the Fourth Crusade, the Fifth Crusade, 6th, 7th, 8th, and 9th. It's a really good book. It's fascinating. It's not very expensive. You can get it on Amazon and paperback for like $7. I think it's five on Kindle. Another one is Just Tell Me the Truth About the Future of the Church, Future of Christianity. This book is about 150 pages. It's got an apologetics glossary, and it breaks down the church from a modern perspective. Seven reasons for the decline of the church, the collapse of doctrinal consistency, determining the source of authority over doctrinal truth claims, modern misunderstanding, secular globalism and the future of Christianity, restoring Christian theism and the sole care of the future, recreating doctrinal, liturgical, and charismatic preaching. It's an excellent book that I recommend for anybody who's in ministry. The audience of this book are preachers and teachers, and it's very important. One book that is in print, but I will be doing a second edition of, is Just Tell Me the Truth About the Early Church Councils. I focus on not all 20-something, but I focus on the main ones, particularly the first 9 or 10. We begin with the Council of Nicaea, and we go through and we talk about all the various changes that occurred as a result of these meetings and why the changes occurred. I am completing Just Tell Me the Truth About the Reformation and Counter-Reformation. The work is done. I'm just formatting it into the small book. Same with Just Tell Me the Truth About Evolution. This book is called Shipwrecked in the Land of King Tobacco, and I went outside my usual subject matter. This book's about the first Washington family immigrant to America. Believe it or not, no one has told the story about George Washington's ancestors. His great-grandfather, John, was the first one to arrive in America. He ended up here on a mission trading tobacco, and his ship wrecked, and he got stuck here. His story is full of fascinating courtroom drama and witches and hangings and him becoming successful, and you see all these unique and uncanny parallels between him and his great-grandson, George. Now, the book looks big, but the story itself is only about 400 pages. The rest of this is bibliography. Like I said, no one's covered this material, so I wanted to make sure I covered all my bases for future researchers. Shipwrecked in the Land of King Tobacco. You can get all of my books on Amazon.com/author/Nicholas Garrett. I want to show you three products that are not on my Amazon page, but are still available in limited supply. This was the first book I ever wrote, called Lovely Day for a Rock Song. Talked about my experiences in the music industry. It's somewhat biographical. It's written in the vein of Ben Franklin's autobiography. And it tells the story of the moderate fame I enjoyed with a hit radio single called Cold on my CD, Lovely Day for a Rock Song. From time to time, I've put the songs up on videos, and I would love to. These are $5. If you want to get one, just send me a message, and we'll get arrangements to get it to you. Or maybe we can use Patreon to make a subscription, and you can get the CD. Finally, in a past life, I was a music teacher, owned a music school, and I was contracted by a major company called Recorded Books to make this DVD, Guitar Lessons That Work. We have 4 half-hour lessons getting into the guitar and playing, scales, chords, and modern rock style guitar. These are all products available through the Evangelist Nick Garrett line. I'm going to continue writing. Now, finally, I want to draw your attention to a mini documentary that I've done on YouTube that isn't getting a lot of attention, but I think is really worth a watch. It's a 3-part series on evolution, but I get away from all the common nomenclature and the arguments between creationism and evolution, and it's really different. I hope you'll give it a chance. I'm going to link it so you can watch it. But do me a favor. This is a series of videos I'd really like to boost up this week in addition to Podcast 6. Let's see if we can generate some interest in this and keep it going. You can look forward to a couple more videos coming this week. A subscriber who I really like asked some pretty cool questions, and I wanted to make sure that I took the time to give him a video to answer them, because they're more than can be answered in a comment. just want to give his name so he knows we're coming, and we will take care of it. Oh, I can't find it right now. Oh, John Thomas. John Thomas had some questions, and we're going to get to those in a separate video. Finally, want to give you some YouTube shout-outs. Bodie Lang. Here's the link to his video on epistemological relativism and selective indignation. He articulates some points we made in Podcast 5 with proper nomenclature, and his video is just 13 minutes. I also want to reference Dr. Taylor Marshall, who I referenced in the beginning. Love you all very much. Thank you for the privilege of allowing me to record these videos and disseminate information to you. I look forward to continuing the process. Before I go, real quick, want to tell you about some articles that you might find interesting. This week, Taiwan approved same-sex marriage for the first time in Asia. Police executed a search warrant for the Catholic Diocese of Dallas. Australia's political candidates grant eternal absolution for gays after Christian rugby player punished for his faith. Multimillionaire who hated God gets radically saved, now helping Christians level up at business and Christ. And Jared Bellin decides to trust God. That's the Christian news this week. I will link it in the video description. And I look forward to talking to you next time.